Welcome back from that very short break. You're still watching The Checkpoint. My name is Nicholas Wasajja. Today, I'm delighted to be hosting the Butambala County MP, Honorable Mwanga Chivumbi. And we are talking about Parliament, the 11th Parliament that has started its work and its oversight function. Honorable, when we broke off, we were still consumed by the question of the size of government. Vis-a-vis service delivery. And my question was, do you think the new government that is taking charge now will be able to deliver in the next 5 years? But going by the argument you were making that time and again it has we've been able to prove that this bloated government is more for political reasons as opposed to service delivery. But I think the leaders in government have not shied away from saying the fact that it is important when balancing powers in politics that everyone sees themselves in that government, be it at the local level, being at parliament, be it at cabinet level. So don't you think it is, I mean, for stability purposes, if everyone wants to feel that their share of the national cake is by having their own in government, it is better than having a lean government that is going to ruffle a bit of feathers and water in the general population.
You should study the new threats to security in sub-Saharan Africa. The number one threat to national security is a young population that is yearning for better life and with scarce opportunities. It threatens the survival of the sub-Saharan states. It's not the lack of representation. The second issue that threatens national security is environment. Because if you are still depending on natural environment for production, for survival, and you are cutting out forests, soon production levels will go low and there will be a population, with the increasing populations, you are going to have scarcity.
And you will have food scarcity.
You had food scarcity, water scarcity. You are likely to have to threaten the national security. The other thing that is threatening national security is corruption. So for as long as governments don't effectively deliver, you can imagine this country. If these Arabs had not sorted out themselves somehow, to stress off the population in terms of externalization of labor with people whom we are saying they are in Chile, in Dubai, in wherever. Okay? Because we had oversaturated Europe, Africans, we had oversaturated America. America is, whether it is Trump or Biden, they are having a common stand on immigrants. They are saying no more entry. It had reached a level where it was threatening. Part of the Trump rise was because
the indigenous Americans
were saying for a job we would do for $12 an hour, an immigrant is willing to do it for $3. Some wasajja from nowhere says, I mean, $3 is good enough, give me the job driving a truck. And for him, it makes a big difference back home. So you'll find these so-called whites were becoming unemployed and needing state social security safety net. They raise up. That's why they were saying they're almost occupying Capitol Hill, saying no way. And no matter what, in Europe.
This is the man that understood.
Part of the drivers of the Brit exit.
Yes.
Okay? Was because people would come from Scandinavian countries, come to Britain for a job, the British, proud as they are, would be wanting $8. The other one says, for me, even $2, I will do. They said, to hell with the European Union. We need to protect our nationality. All the explanations they were giving, they were rational. But inherently, they were saying, no, ours is ours, and it was threatening the Europe. It was in France. The wave is everywhere. Therefore, there is no longer a world out there where we are going to produce so fertile as we are, and so incompetent in running our affairs as we are, and poorly to the world. Soon that market in the Saudi Arabia, okay, is going to be oversaturated very, very soon, because they are not also very efficient in doing many things. China will not tolerate you to do this kind of thing. India has excess number
China,
of people.
China also has so, its own population boom.
India will not, and these are the growing economies. Mm-hmm. Now, that means pressure back home is going to mount. If there had not been a stress, you would be having no matter of classified expenditure. That's why today you look at our budget, okay, and it is increasing in defense and in classified expenditure. But Uganda is at peace, border to border. Konya is in the Central African Republic. Why are we not seeing a peace dividend in terms of lower budgets, in terms of suit? Reason why? The population is restless. It is the population that is saying to Eberemu now. And it will get any profit. No matter, even if you eliminated Chagulanyi, this is the population that started. It was with Sebagala, it went with the VSJ, it went with everyone. You can manipulate it for some time and intimidate it. And I can tell you, if it was not for sheer control of coercive resources, they would have removed the government. And not because they hate a government, it's because they deserve better life. So, for me, a mere tinkering with the structures of governance without addressing the core of the drivers of poverty and unemployment, having efficient service delivery, having value for money. Can you imagine? You borrow, you begin to pay interest for the money you don't use. No home run is like that. Where you go to a neighbor and borrow money to buy his supper, and then you are unable to put dinner on the table, and yet you pay back the magova. I mean, even if it was so insane as it is, you can't run a home economy like the way we run Uganda. It is and you have four ministers in the Ministry of some of the finest economists in this country sit
at the Ministry of Finance,
and these are guys who borrow money. Can you believe we now borrow for recurrent expenditure? Recurrent means like to run these lights
it is a reality.
You don't have to believe that you can, because if recurrent is money you need to run your life. If it is a home, you need money for supper, for fuel, for electricity bill, for that, not for building a mizigo. Now, you no longer have money as a country. And do you know how much? Our recurrent expenditure are 28 trillion. Our net collection in URA are 21. That means you are going to borrow over 7 trillion to make sure you buy a fuel. So that is the kind you are. For me, that is a bigger threat to national security, to stability, than any threat you would ever imagine. And it's the one that the president has been trying to. That's why he tinkers around. You buy full figure, you go baby cool, you go, who are these fellows, the other man with the stick?
Butcher man.
because the ghetto youth, okay? Whom they are calling a ghetto, I don't know whether they are really ghetto youth is here, but the downtrodden people.
The downtrodden.
Yes. The can you believe, you I know you are safe from school, but you can look out for your classmates. For people you studied with, some young girls are married to border people with their degrees. Some are living a very miserable life. You meet them and say, the OB, they want to hide. I meet people I went with to school and they were very bright, scored very good grades. I meet them in villages and were like, hey, you live here? This is what life has come to. No hope and all awaiting death. They can no longer afford to put their children to the schools, the very schools they went to. Do you know how much it hurts for a teacher who cannot pay fees for school where he teaches? I mean, you work for this radio, but you cannot run an advert on this radio. In case of a problem, you run away to some poor station. It is incredible, it hurts. All those school teachers you see, Most of them, without helping from a school, they cannot put their children to schools where they teach. All the nurses and all the doctors cannot be treated in the hospitals where they treat people. If they fall sick, they've got to go to some Kasaidi clinic because they can't afford. So that, for me, is a bigger threat to national security than the threat that people, than saying, because the people of Butambala need somewhere to be seen. Mm. I mean, over time they will know it is
you raise a very, you raise a very valid point. And but we are here now. That is the point. We are here now. There is a government. You in the opposition. You've taken up your space in the opposition, and we must move for the next 5 years. And when you talk about a bigger threat to national security being the rising, the uncontrolled number of youth, the upsurge in youth unemployment, you talk about issues like the environment and food security and all that. If these pose a threat to the scramble for land, if all these threats threaten the national security, that means you and I are also non-secure. You get it? So that means it is a national call, it is a national duty for all of us to find a solution to resolving these issues. And then my question would be, what would you then propose that will ensure efficient service delivery to address these challenges?
Yes, first of all, we've not kept quiet about these challenges. So we are shouting loudest to say that you are skinning the animal the wrong way. That's the beginning point. And my role sometimes, one time when we were debating in parliament, Honorable Semuju said, but what are we going to achieve? He said, Ako, now, if people are stealing money in a bank and you are there, and all you can do is to raise an alarm, please raise it. Because that's all you can do. It's the thing, the three notions is start where you are, use what you have, do all you can. And don't give up. So we are working within those notions of within our limited capacity. We are sharing. In every forum you call us, we will not hesitate to tell you the truth. Even if Jesus came back, we will say these are realities. Secondly, it has to translate into a demand. Okay? Not only by politicians, but by the population. Because at the end of the day, a politician is also a human being. At some point, he will want to put food on his table. So if you rely on me,
who is motto,
that I could also one day think, oh, I'm going to 50. I have my children. They also need to go to school. I'm likely to make compromises.
I'm going to tell you a very interesting story. We were at a conference, an FDC conference, and one of your friends in the FDC told me, Nicholas, look here, I have been at this game for all my life, and it is going nowhere. He was simply saying, I'm tired. I'm tired.
Dictatorship can wear you down, and you reach a point of breakdown and say, But the population, once empowered with knowledge and with the skills to make a demand, because for them they live it every day, they can't give up because it is existential. They either do that or die. They don't face the easy options of top politicians that, okay, if I'm giving up, I will be compromised, I'll do sebu guao. So they don't have that latitude. So for them, either they have supper today in the morning. I can tell you a life story. Today in the morning, as I was getting out of the gate, my askari told me there is a kid waiting on the gate. Okay? They are not even from here, there, wherever. So then I was getting out to say, I'll talk to them as I was getting. What were they saying? They said, Mommy wants to talk to you. It's about what? We never had supper. At my gate, a kid knocked about 8 years. And I know the family. Quite often, when they don't have supper, they knock on my gate. So, but how often will people go and knock on neighbors' gates because they are
dehumanizing
that you have to knock on somebody's gate? And these, when you look at the children, they are as handsome, they are as beautiful as you can be. But that's yet I live in the morning. Quite often when I'm driving, I quite find people say, "Honorable, stop." And they are genuine. And they could be as smart as you, as me. I can even be getting out and they walk here, says me, these are realities we go for. And say, and it's not telling a story, it's not right. Say anything you can afford. And if you give them 20K, you would see the smile you'll put on their face. So at one time, the numbers are going to overwhelm our fences we are building. And for me, I simply say, there is no better lamb being raised than the real. Therefore, response must be commensurate to the challenges we face. And this changing the life of a country is not magic. Now, for a country that has capacity to generate 20 trillion in local revenue, and it has a food security, well run properly, it can balance off things. You can actually not borrow.
Interestingly, 22 trillion from 1.5 registered taxpayers. So the rest of the other 40 million is...
Yeah, because my mother in the village, who is not part of our economy, people say money economy only, should join the money economy. My mother is in money economy. He produces cassava, matoke, gnats, whatever, and feeds himself. So why do you want to push him to a market when he can sustain himself? Because that thing that, you know, you produce for the market and then you buy from the market is also somehow misleading. So when you want to have real figures, you count that even my mother, who has can have 10 liters or 5 liters of milk from his cow, gets his cow down, takes it to a chitoke, gets a bunch, and is able to feed 10 children. Compound that in your figures. Don't say, I'm not in the money economy. Why do I need money when I have my food?
Yes.
So don't discourage that person. So the Europeans are pushing us onto the market. Look at the situation we are finding ourselves in today. When I was growing up in the village, and you are harvesting maize, they would see these are the good ones. They let them dry up, put them in a chibanyi, and those are the ones we shall use to plant. Today, government must take seeds to every home. Homestead.
And the target is at least 2.5 million.
And 2.5 homestead. To take them seeds. Season per season. Ridiculous. The speaker was announcing, that government has delivered the handy hose. That every home is going to get two.
And you. So.
But in which space of time? It will be in 5 years we are going to get two.
Two hand hose.
In 2 years, are you going to use two hand hose in a home? On average, so if government is slowly being squeezed to that, you would see that we are not applying the right policies to meet the challenge. Look, we went into oil, and we have been pushing a lot of money in oil production. If we had just put half of the money we have invested in oil into mineral production, we would have the money to even invest in the oil industry. If we had put small amount of money into railway, we would transport our cargo. You saw the president giving you the figures. More cheaply, more easily. But because the leaders own the trucks, and the Chinese, the manufacturers of these trucks wanted to import them. Can you believe you have a railway line between Ruzira and the other place in Rubaga, okay, buried. For you to move from Luzira to Masaka on Victoria, it is so quick than going the roadway, so cheap.
Yes,
but you've chosen difficult options and very expensive ones. So with the Victoria, you can go around this country very, very cheaply with that natural God-given lake. You can simply go on it very quickly. You are choosing to build roads. You are borrowing, instead of borrowing, using money to buy these other things, you are borrowing money to build roads. These roads, before you even pay back the money, they will need rebuilding. And you will find yourself in a vicious circle of paying loans and borrowing and borrowing and borrowing.
At some point, we were praising this government for having very good policy documents, but lacking on implementation. But you seem to be saying we are choosing the wrong policy direction.
Yeah, even the policy direction, I've told you, I've had the benefit of to sit in a committee, because every policy boils down to money allocation.
Yes.
They simply say, if you want to understand the government, follow the money. Now, when I see where money goes, for instance, today, most of our minerals are going to China. Okay? Those that are being mined for export. Now, Chinese goods are flooding our market. Now, we borrow to build a road for China to take raw materials and to transport goods. Why should my mother be the one paying? It's the Chinese that should build the road, because they are the net beneficiary. But Africans are failing to tell these Chinese fellows that, look, wait a minute, it should be you to pay for the road, because you are taking the minerals, you are bringing your goods. For example, you are investing money in energy and road infrastructure. I'll tell you why they can't address the problem. Those sectors are highly mechanized. If you want to know, you go to this Northern Bypass. How many people are working there?
But you see,
how many people are working there? Because they have an excavator, they have the heavy trucks, they have the dozers, they have everything. They are heavily mechanized, and therefore they cannot have a trickle down on the economy. Yet, you don't want to invest money in national housing. If you invested money in a house, I don't know of a country that doesn't have a sound housing policy. Because once you have a sound housing policy, one, you reduce the uncertainty of the elite to steal. Because people are stealing to build a house. Okay? Now, you'll be working for new vision.
Your former leader in the Democratic Party used to call it the 1, 2, 3, 4 of society. One wife,
yes.
Two-bedroom house, three children, I think three children, and a four-wheel drive.
And a four-wheel drive. Yes. So that's why the investment should have been, you prepare a graduate. As you get out of school, okay, we ensure you'll get a house. And your needs, people are rational. The moment you create these uncertainties and you create affordable schools and a sound health system, you will reduce the scarcity for need for people to steal money.
The urge for people to steal money.
Because our people are godly. Because either they are extremely...
Don't go there.
I want to go there. Either they're extremely deceitful to even God, or they are terrible 1 inch, because all these people who steal money, every Sunday they go to church. Every night they say that prayer. I sing their car, they have the rosary. They have that. Now, how come the people who go to church have rosaries, say those night prayers, respect the Ten Commandments, at the same time go to office to steal? That means the environment they work in needs to be addressed. Otherwise, they don't do it willfully.
Honorable, we are really running out of time. But the other question would be, we are going into a second year running, being hit badly by COVID-19 and unprecedented in the first lockdown, 2020, from March for so many months. We didn't have this upsurge in numbers. We didn't have this upsurge in deaths. Although the COVID-19 effects battered the economy badly, right now we are talking about a direct effect on our lives. And it seems you no longer have to tell people to wear their masks. Do you think, but also interestingly, I'll give you an example. There's a budget cut in the Ministry of Health. And there was an increase in classified expenditure to I think 5 trillion in one financial year. Now, the Minister of Health, the reality is we are short of oxygen supply. Now we have to depend on the Ministry of Defense now to manufacture oxygen for this dire situation. How do you think government is approaching this whole COVID issue? And isn't it something that we should worry about as a nation?
If you go and read our report on the first supplementary on COVID,
yes,
the report which I wrote together with the Karuhanga, which Parliament did not listen to very well, we would say this second hit of COVID is partially because of incompetence and corruption. God was with us mercifully. Because the first lockdown was to achieve two things: mitigate the spread, prepare the infrastructure,
yes,
in case the mitigation fails.
And Seveni consistently made that argument. That argument
the
is
president
here,
spoke
but
to it very eloquently, that we are locking you down to mitigate, but to also have space, okay, in the remaining time to prepare for in case the mitigation fails. Now, even Wananchi, the Wananchis came in and helped. I will give you an example. They raised money. I don't know the figures, but it's like 23 billion. And the money came to Parliament. I moved in the budget committee. The ministry was allocated to buy 223 pickups, double cabins. We said, but wait a minute. We are talking about a COVID response. Do pickups take COVID patients? The Ministry of Health, smart as they are, had already ordered for 222 pickups.
Yes.
Money raised from Wananchi. Okay, I'll tell you the second leg to it, that's so hurtful. So in the budget committee, I convinced the committee and I moved in the committee, later on the whole parliament adopted it, that okay, let us have half. Let every district have at least one ambulance out of that money. And the rest would be used to buy the pickups. The ministry said the directive of the president was to buy pickups. We asked, why did the president then bring it to parliament? Because the powers to appropriate to a purpose lies with parliament. Now, here you are. In my district now, there's only one ambulance. For every COVID patient, they have to call the center to send a military ambulance. The ones of the MPs, because the election is now 5 years from wherever it is, first of all, they are mechanically down. Others don't have money to buy new ones. And it's not politically paying. So they are not yet at that standpoint. So they are not there. Now, so what that does, that also the other story is, they had secured pickups, okay, for $30,000. These ones they ordered, each was for 50,000. And that's why you speak to members of that COVID task force. Those that are honest don't want to come near those decisions. Because they had never seen it. Even by the time they went for the money raised from Wananchi, it had been used for other purposes and the treasury had to go and borrow and repay.
Honorable, where does that leave a sick population?
Now, here you are. You have regional hospitals. They were, until recently in the budget committee, they needed 1.5 billion each to put the ICT something scan that instantly tells you 1.5 billion.
So if you have
it had not been budgeted for until the budget
comes, even less than 10 billion.
They needed 15 billion shillings to do all the regional hospitals. Sad as it is, the Mulago wing, where there is oxygen plant, the contractor ate the money. That's why that plant can't work. And I don't want to use this forum to tell you who contracted the production of oxygen in Mulago, very high up in government. Now, you are having a country hit. Had you gone into manufacture? Okay, we went in masks, and which we never gave out. But have we gone into manufacture those simple drugs? We would have a stockpile of drugs that, because we had tested drugs that positively respond to COVID. We have a shortage of supplies. So all I know is that because of the absence of a budget committee and the entire government is being set up, we don't have another supplementary. But you can be so sure on 1st June, they're going to spend the 3% on this. So we are being hit, and we are paying a price for corruption, mismanagement,
wrong prioritization. Where does that leave the population? What's your message to the sick population?
No, the sick we population, are one, first of all, as you appeal, to know, yes, there is a government, you can demand it, but it's your life.
Sure.
Okay? Do the simple, doable things. Wear a mask, okay? Social distance. Keep yourself clean. If possible, eat right and well and timely. Treat every opportunistic small disease like a flu. Because, you know, when you seek a flu, treat it promptly so that you don't have body weaknesses. Those who have space exercise, you know, there are things you can do. Those who can have water, do the steaming, in a dusty basket with a blanket, do that steaming, put yourself up there and healthy. Two, take care of your neighbor. Have social responsibility. Please tell the public, these weddings, these nyimbe, these burials, a dead person is dead. There is no joy in a dead person you are accompanying. They are not that bad that they will be so happy that on their death others followed them.
So politicians are notorious for trying to run.
We are all asking population that those things we can do, let's do them. As for the government, and I have heard from security circles, some of them are shying away to enforce these regulations. We must encourage them not to abuse rights, but enforce them.
Sure.
Be assertive, but don't be aggressive. You see, sometimes when you tell these hill-trained fellows to enforce, they think they beat. They think they will incarcerate people. They think they will extort. So we are saying, security, please be assertive in enforcing rules and regulations, but don't dehumanize our people. Don't beat them. The reason why they are in the markets is that they are looking for dinner for their family. But please tell them that can also be dangerous. The other thing is that we will urge government, and I don't want you to use this forum to make that call, colors. But for the government of Uganda, I think we have enough resources. I keep repeating it. Well utilized, we can sort out this country.
The government, we have enough resources. If well utilized, we can sort out the problem. But for you, the individual out there, it is important that you keep yourself safe, because with or without the government, you need your life. Be sure to catch the checkpoint next week.